a dog may lesson just not bothering to plan? That's a question for TEFLologists. When I read this book, is it better to skim or scan? That's a question for TEFLologists. Can you be a good teacher if you have a CELTA? Or should you invest in an MA or a DELTA? From politics to methodology, we'll discuss them all on TEFLology.
Welcome to another interview episode of the TEFLology podcast. Today's interviewee is Diane Hawley Nagatomo. Diane has been living and teaching in Japan for more than 30 years and is currently an associate professor at Ochanomizu University in Tokyo. Diane has a PhD in linguistics from Macquarie University and has authored and co-authored numerous EFL textbooks for the Japanese market. Her book, Exploring Japanese University English Teachers' Professional Identity, was published by Multilingual Matters in February 2012. She currently has a second book underway too. She is the coordinator for the JALT GALESIG. GALE stands for Gender Awareness in Language Education. Rob met up with her at her institution to discuss teacher identities and gender in ELT, with a primary focus on Japan. We hope you enjoy the interview.
Hi, this is Rob, and I'm sitting here with Diane Hawley Nagatomo. Thank you very much for joining me.
Thank you for asking me.
So, first, perhaps we'll talk a little about your career. You describe yourself in your 2012 book as being kind of a backpacker teacher. Can you talk about how you went from being that kind of teacher to being a professor now?
Okay. Well, I wasn't exactly a backpacker teacher because I didn't go anywhere else.
Right.
I think most backpackers move around from place to place, but Japan was my first stop off, and then I just stayed, and I was going to stay here for a year, learn fluent Japanese, maybe travel a little bit afterwards and then go back to California and get on with my real life. But 1 year became two, became 20, and you know, I came in 1979, so you can do the math on that.
Right. You currently work at Ochanomizu University.
Yes.
In Japan. And how did you start doing that job?
Well, I came to Japan in 1979, at a time when there were not that many foreigners in Japan, and I think I was very fortunate that I made some very good connections.
Mm.
And I started working at a place called Chiyoda Business College, because literally I met somebody in the street that worked there, and then somehow I started teaching there, and then from there I met a professor who was working there, and then from that point I started working at Tamagawa University.
Mm-hmm.
And I worked at Tamagawa University from 1984 to 95.
Right.
And then I've been at Ochanomizu University since then. So it started off with just being in the right place at the right time and meeting good people that helped my career.
Right. You mentioned in the book about how in Japanese universities, the Japanese English teachers are kind of, it's easier for them to get jobs in the kind of the center, getting the tenured jobs, and the foreign teachers tend to be more on the outside. Do you think that's a situation that's changed since you started working in the country?
I think that the situation hasn't changed so much, but I think the number of people who are teaching in Japan and the number of positions that are open are more.
Mm.
When the university started getting into trouble with the decline of student population, and there were all those, you know, kind of small liberal art colleges that were established, to attract students, they started hiring foreign teachers and calling courses like, you know, international development courses or global courses. But I think that still a lot of foreign teachers are still on the periphery of that. And because many of those universities have to adjust their budgets, and they do that with personnel
right
cutting. Yeah.
Okay. And so
You wrote your book about teacher identities mm-hmm. in Japanese universities. Can you explain a little about the key thesis of the book?
Okay. So I got the idea when I talked to a student who was teaching at a university, and when I asked her about, you know, how's it going, how do you like it, she was having a lot of conflict because it was a low-level school, and she couldn't really relate to her students who were putting on makeup in class or sleeping and not paying attention.
Right.
And I started thinking that, you know, the Japanese university teachers, so in my 2012 book, I only talk about Japanese teachers, not foreign teachers, and they are usually products of a very elite background in Japanese universities, graduates of Tokyo University or Waseda, high-level schools, but they often teach in low-level universities.
Right.
And so their educational experiences that have prepared them for their careers are quite different from the students that they're teaching. So that's how I got kind of interested in this. And Japanese teachers usually major in literature or linguistics. Recently, they're more in TESOL-related fields, but traditionally, it was, you know, English-related topics. And so I was kind of interested in how the teachers, you know, work through that process.
Right. And so did you identify any particular conflicts that influenced the way that these teachers constructed their identities? Could you give some examples
of
those?
Well, I only talked to seven teachers in my book. So if I talked to seven different teachers, they would have completely different stories. But I found that the teachers didn't necessarily teach in ways that they were taught themselves, but they liked to teach in ways that they thought were better.
Right.
So two of my participants, they had taken classes with foreign teachers and they had taken communicative courses, but they kind of liked the classes taught by their Japanese teachers better because they felt they were getting in-depth knowledge about the subject, whereas the techniques that the foreigners taught them, they thought, oh, I can do that on my own.
Right.
And I thought that is one of the differences then of like a professor and a student. A professor will think these kinds of things, but how many people go on to become professors after that? It's only a few people. So I think there's a kind of gap in expectations of students and expectations of teachers.
Right. How about between the staff themselves, the staff members themselves? So like, for example, the older and more novice faculty members.
Well, I didn't come across anything like that in my research. And I think for the most part, you know, in a university, most teachers have a lot of autonomy and they do what they want.
Right.
So I don't think there's a whole lot of, you know, the left hand and the right hand really paying that much attention to what's going on in tenured kind of positions.
Right.
Now, if it's a language center, then there's going to be some problems. And I can give you an example from my current research, as I'm working on this new book. And I interviewed a person who is a tenured teacher at a university, and she's in charge of all of the core English classes. And there's been a lot of problems getting the Japanese teachers to move away from grammar translation textbooks into the communicative-based textbooks. That is the basis of their curriculum. And the teachers resisted it so much that when the school started a new faculty, they just decided to hire dispatch teachers instead because they were less troublesome.
Right.
And it was because the Japanese teachers just wouldn't change, and then the students complained a lot about it.
Right.
So
yeah, there was a quote in your book from one of the teachers who I think she came across as not really being that enthusiastic about teaching English as a language, and she said that she couldn't be one of those entertaining teachers. So who do you think she was referring to when she used the phrase the entertaining teachers?
I think she's probably referring to foreign teachers.
Right.
And that's, you know, another topic that I've been kind of exploring these recently, the two competing ideologies of ego and eikaiwa. And ego is, you know, English language. It's usually taught by Japanese teachers.
Right.
It's the meat and potatoes of learning. It's the real stuff. It's related to test and translation, turning it back, English back into Japanese.
Right.
And then Eikaiwa is kind of the fun thing that is only done when, you know, you've got a little bit of extra time. And I think that until these two ideologies merge together, there's always going to be a problem with this.
Do you think this ideology or these two ideologies are in the minds of the professors or the minds of the students or both?
I think in both.
Right.
And that's... it's related to the kinds of classes that foreign teachers are often assigned to teach. The Japanese teachers will usually teach content-based courses, whereas foreign teachers, especially if they're in language centers, are teaching basic skills classes. There's a different level of respect that comes along with this, and this is something that carries over through high school, I think, with ALTs, where the high school teachers are teaching their students that, you know, your foreigners are your best friends, so, you know, we're all on a first-name basis and, and things like that. So it's a kind of ongoing thing that needs to be addressed.
Right, right. And you said that you had seven participants in the study. Only one of those participants was male. First of all, why was that? And secondly, was there any particular difference in their experiences of being kind of novice academics?
Okay. The fact that I only had one male participant was just a matter of chance. And actually, I did have a few more participants in the initial stages of my research. But when I decided to narrow it down into novice participants, I had to eliminate a few of my the participants.
Right.
But I wanted to have more teachers, but, you know, because I was doing three interviews with each person, that was a lot of transcription and everything. And I didn't start off with this research thinking about gender at all. And I was basically, I just wanted to look at how teachers become initiated into this community of practice of university teachers. Because, you know, it was a time of great change when, you know, the older professors under the older system were beginning to retire. New professors that in the 2000s, they were getting their college education in the 80s and 90s when there was a lot of, you know, international travel. And you know, so people had changed a lot in Japan. So I wanted to see how, you know, these people are, especially they're the new generation of people with PhDs, overseas research, and so on. They're very different. So the fact that I only had one guy was just a complete matter of, that's how it ended up. I couldn't find anybody else.
And so were there any differences between his experience and the experience of the female participants?
I think so. But it's all, you know, very much related to individual contexts of where they're working. So I don't know if I can say it's a gender related thing. Although I do think it probably is somewhat related to gender. He was a new teacher in his department, in his university, but he was being quite nicely pulled into the inner circle. The older generation of professors were retiring, and he was being wooed by the next incoming power group. And a lot of that kind of socialization goes, you know, after work socializing, and so on. Whether or not that would have happened if he had been female, I don't know. But my one of my other participants, who was also a relatively new teacher, she was not invited to join any of the, you know, powerful committees. But that could be related to, it was a much, much larger university. So there could be many factors. I don't want to say exactly that these were caused by gender, but they are, you know, things to consider that are definitely related to gender.
Okay. I was asking you about gender particularly because I know that you're active within the JALT Gender Awareness in Language Education Special Interest Group. So what is the kind of the purpose of that special interest group?
The purpose is to raise awareness that in a language classroom, gender plays a role. Well, in any kind of classroom, any kind of situation, gender plays a very important role.
Right.
And it is in the way that teachers relate to students. It's in the way that students relate to each other. It's in textbook materials, as you know. Teachers use, you know, textbook materials that refer to men in certain ways and women in certain ways. And all of this is, you know, reinforcing gender stereotypes.
Right.
So this SIG can look at things like that, or it can look at, you know, discourse analysis. There are many, many areas. And it's not only for women. It's, you know, gender influences, you know, everybody.
Right.
So that's the kind of thing that we look at in JALT. And unfortunately, a lot of people are like, oh, I thought that has nothing to do with me. I'm a guy.
Right.
But actually, it doesn't, especially in Japan, when if you're an English teacher, chances are probably most of your students are female.
Mm-hmm.
And so we are exposed to a lot of these issues, whether you want to be or not.
Right. Mm-hmm. So you said that you worked in, like, for example, Tamagawa University and what was the other one? The business college?
Oh, Chiyoda Business College,
right.
Yeah.
And now you work in a women's only university. Do you see any particular difference between the classroom dynamics of the students in a mixed group and or a single-sex class?
Well, when I was teaching at Tamagawa University, I would say it was like 90% girls anyway.
Right.
So the boys would, like, cluster together in the back, all four of them, and rarely venture out into the main group. Now I'm teaching part-time at Nihon University. I just started from April. And out of two classes there, I only have one female student.
Wow.
So that is a completely different thing for me. But the dynamics of the students, I can't really remember.
Right. Yeah. So, for example, when I taught in classes that were nearly all male university students, they were very kind of loud and assertive and that kind of thing. And when I taught classes of mixed students, the male students tended to dominate the discussions a little bit. But now that I teach all female students, they're just like a class of all male students. They're very loud and assertive and that kind of thing. So.
Yeah, I think there is that, and I think that, you know, students, they don't have to be shy. Like, if I ask my students, if I ask them to write essays, you know, what are the advantages of female universities, they write things like, oh, I don't have to wear makeup. But actually, I think that they do feel more confident in developing their skills. And the students here are very competent and confident for the most part.
Right.
But in any kind of class, there's going to be the loud ones and the quiet ones.
Mm.
And that, I think, is true anywhere.
Okay. You wrote an article, I think maybe 2 years ago, about housewives and the cottage industry, the cottage eikaiwa industry. So what issues do you think affect women teaching in those kinds of situations?
Okay. Yeah, that's a part of my current research that I've been working on, looking at foreign female teachers in Japan,
right,
who in particular have Japanese spouses.
Mm.
And I've been looking at them in different contexts, and that article looks at private teaching, eikaiwa teaching. And there are a lot of issues there that are at stake that are in that article, and also that hopefully I'll be publishing soon.
Nice.
One is the issue of money. If they're married to a Japanese salaried worker, they have to keep their income earnings under a certain level to maintain their dependency status.
Right.
So that's one of the issues, you know. So if they go over that, then they lose a lot of benefits, and then they have to pay for their insurance and their tax. So if they go over, I think, 1.1 million yen, I could be wrong on the details,
right,
they have to earn about 3 million yen to make it worthwhile.
Mm.
And that's not easy to do when you're teaching, you know,
right,
at home. But there are people in the cottage industry, eikaiwa business, who have created kind of lucrative businesses and lucrative schools. And sometimes they, you know, built additions onto their homes, or they have a particular area of their home that they're using for schools, or they're renting a place. and they're quite professional, but their neighbors often think that they aren't.
Right.
And this is going back to the ego e kaiwa problem. One of my participants in my study said that a juku in her town has started a kind of negative advertising campaign against her.
Really?
By saying things like, you know, we teach grammar because we know what Japanese students really need, not like the foreign teacher in town who only plays games with students.
Right.
And actually she's the only other teacher in town, so it's kind of obvious that it was her.
Right.
And she actually lost a couple of students that way because the parents got scared. So they have this image that, you know, because she's a foreigner, she's just playing games and not really teaching. Whereas if it's ego, it's involving some kind of suffering and, you know, intense study. So that's the real business. Also, with these women, if they're dealing with like the children of their children, I mean, the friends of their children and the parents, then sometimes the other parents don't see them as professional teachers.
Right.
And so they try to negotiate payment. And the people that are successful in this field have managed to get the payment system down pack. And, you know, when I first came to Japan, I was teaching to the neighbors, and they would pay you sometimes, or they wouldn't pay, or whatever. It was always a nightmare.
Right.
But the people who are successful get that system down, and then they have to because they're paying taxes. But people don't realize that, and they think they're just doing, you know, something fun, or all the money they earn is, you know, to go shopping with.
Right.
And for many people, it's they're really supporting their families by this kind of business.
Right, right. So those people are kind of established in Japan, maybe have been here for quite a long time. Do you think that the issues are different for teachers who come to Japan perhaps to start their careers? Do you think there are different issues for kind of novice teachers and for more experienced teachers?
Well, things always change, you know, things always change. In my study that I've just finished, I mean, basically you could hang a sign outside your door and in the 70s and 80s, and within 2 days you'd have 100 students.
Right.
That doesn't happen anymore. And even, you know, my participants who opened their schools in 2002, by 2012, there was a big downturn in the Eikaiwa business. So I think it's not as easy to kind of get a career started in Japan nowadays as it was before.
Right.
Most people leave EFL right away.
Right.
It's a temporary job for people who want to kind of go out and see the world and then go back and get on with their real lives.
Right. Yeah. And do you think that this situation is the same in other countries? Obviously, your research is focused on Japan, it's where you're based. But do you have any ideas about whether the situation is the same in other countries around the world?
It's not that different.
Right.
There's a person named Nielsen. I can't remember his first name, but he wrote a book called Traveler's Tales. And it's basically about the expatriate EFL teacher and how, you know, many of them leave the field right away because it's not a very well-paid job.
Right.
There's a lot of job insecurity and a lot of difficulties.
Right.
If you teach in a place that is kind of a hardship area, like Saudi Arabia, then you can get paid really well.
Right.
But if you teach in a place that everybody wants to go, like the south of Spain, that was his example, then the conditions and payments are really bad.
Right.
So it's a kind of supply and demand situation. But he gave a few examples, like one woman got fired after a couple of years in, I forget which country, because she wasn't foreign enough anymore. She'd been contaminated too much by the local culture that they wanted, you know, another fresh person to come in. In Italy, they changed the status of foreign university teachers to assistants, and they promoted Italian assistants to the teaching positions. Mm. Now, I could be mixed up on this, so please don't, you know, believe that that is... I'm speaking from memory on
that. Was that the Lettori controversy? Is that
something like that, yeah.
I think, is it David Petrie, I think, writes about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, interesting. So maybe just to finish off the interview, we've talked a little about professional identity, teacher identities, and also about gender and ELT. If our listeners want to do some more reading on these topics, what things would you recommend for them to look at?
Well, if you are interested in, like, looking at gender and ELT in Japan, Roz Appleby has a very good book. It's called Men and Masculinities in Global English Language Teaching, and she's also written a few articles. She looks at the charisma man phenomenon and how, you know, male experiences as teachers in Japan are different from female teachers. Mm. If you want to read about it in a different context, let's say in China, Fiona Stanley has written some articles and a book called Superheroes in Shanghai, and that's pretty interesting. If you're interested in other contexts, Roz Appleby also has a book called ELT, Gender and International Development, which is also an interesting book on that. So books about professional identity. Well, Patrick Kiernan has a very interesting book called Deconstructing Narrative Identity in English Language Teaching, Exploring Teacher Interviews in Japanese and English. And that's pretty interesting. Articles, I would recommend Amy Tsui's article that's in the TESOL Quarterly, where she does a narrative, a study of a Chinese participant named Ming Fang. Mm-hmm. That's very interesting. To get an overview of identity, I would recommend... I'm not sure how to pronounce the name, Beijard, B-E-I-J-A-A-R-D, and they have some overviews of teacher identity, which are worth looking into. Mm-hmm. Teacher identity and other areas overlap, like teacher beliefs and teacher knowledge, so they're kind of mixed up together and talked about under the same kind of umbrella.
Right. Those sound like very good recommendations. So thank you very much for joining me and for agreeing to be part of the interview.
Thank you for inviting me.
Okay. Thank you very much for listening to today's episode. We hope you enjoyed it. As always, if you'd like to get in contact with us, there are a number of different ways you can do so. You can email us at tefelology@gmail.com. You can follow us on Twitter at tefelology. And if you feel like it, you can even leave a review on our iTunes site. Reviews really help to make the podcast better, so we really appreciate your feedback. We'll return again with a regular episode soon.